We cannot produce modern integrated circuits without EDA software. Two companies control this critical industry, Cadence and Synopsys. Each have market caps of about $70 to $80 billion as of this writing. How did they come to dominate this field? In today's video, we trace the founding and rise of an EDA duopoly. But first, a reminder about the Asianometry Patreon. Subscribe to the early access tier, and I really appreciate it. Thank you, and on with the show. We should begin with a brief overview of integrated circuit or IC design. It begins with a high-level abstraction of the chip. This is implemented in a register transfer level or RTL language, either VHDL or Verilog. Automatic synthesis tools and a standard cell library then turn that RTL into a netlist of gates. After that, physical design tools are used to lay out the netlist's gates onto the circuit as well as route the wires connecting them. We then use simulation and verification tools to make sure that the design does not violate any of the design rules imposed by a foundry like TSMC or GlobalFoundries. Finally, we pass over an OASIS or GDS2 artwork file to said foundry, and our chip comes out like 4 to 6 months later. If you're interested in learning more about how the chip design process goes, I recommend you check out the Zero to ASIC course run by friend of the show, Matt Venn. Matt is great. In the beginning, EDA tools were all internally developed by the semiconductor companies themselves. There was no EDA industry, but this changed in the early 1960s and 1970s with the rise of what we call the first generation of EDA companies, Applicon, Calma, and Computer Vision. Calma was the high flyer of the three. Founded in the 1960s, its first big product digitized analog charts of an oil or gas well's performance over time, called the digitizer. Such data can then be fed into other analytics packages. After the arrival of a math PhD named Joe Sukocnik, the company produced the Graphical Design System, or GDS. GDS digitized analog information, but also had a display terminal so that users can view and edit what was being digitized. In the early 1970s, people first drew the design, meaning a combination of circuits, onto paper. Then they transferred that paper design to a red photographic film called rubylith by literally cutting it. We then photographically shrink the design to the IC's actual size with cameras. This manual process was delicate, so you can see why the GDS, which can digitize that analog artwork and let people edit it, made sense. In the early 1970s, Calma sold GDS systems to Intel and other semiconductor makers. GDS and other systems of the era monetized their, quote, computer-aided design, end quote, or CAD programs, by reselling special customized workstation computers by the seat at very high prices. So, hardware. In 1978, Calma is acquired by United Telecommunications. United is the ancestor of what is now Sprint, or I guess T-Mobile US. United largely left the company alone, but then in 1980 sold them to General Electric for $100 million, believing that Calma's manufacturing-heavy business did not fit in its computer portfolio. GE intended to put Calma together with other CAD-related companies it had acquired to make the, quote, factory of the future, end quote, thinking that computers are going to revolutionize how we designed items. The match did not work well. GE was a huge company in a stable industry, with an inflated belief in its own style of management. A Silicon Valley startup could not be more different. Talents started to leave. The 1980s saw major changes to IC design. Investment by the government and major companies had discovered new algorithms and tools to produce netlists and layout circuits. The number of circuits on IC started to eclipse that of circuit boards, a major shift in focus for CAD software. With the first generation companies struggling to stay with these trends, a second generation of CAD companies emerged. Daisy Systems, Valid Logic, and Mentor Graphics were the hottest of this cohort, but there were maybe 90 of these startups. Almost all of them also monetized their software with customized workstations. This deep binding of hardware and software became a massive liability in the late 1980s when cheap, powerful Unix workstations from Sun Microsystems and Silicon Graphics hit the market. Calma, Applicon, Daisy, and the hot EDA companies could not easily unbundle their software from their hardware. For instance, Applicon wrote their software entirely in DEC assembly language. The only survivors of this shakeout were those who either unbundled their software from their hardware offerings, Mentor was the only one of the hot three to do so, or started off entirely software only, like the two startups we're about to discuss next. In 1982, a former IC engineer from TI and Data General named Glenn Antel, as well as two Taiwanese immigrants named Paul Huang and Ping Chow, co-founded a startup called ECAD. Huang and Chow had worked at National Semiconductor, producing software to do a specific type of physical verification, called Layout versus Schematic, or LVS. It checks an IC's layout to see if it still fits the circuit schematics. This is part of a larger category that we call design rule checking, which is what we do to a design before we send it over to a foundry. Glenn Antel hired Huang and Chow to a mini computer company called Systems Engineering Labs, or SEL, in Sunnyvale, working in the chipset design team. The team had to use the company's SEL mini computers to do chip design, so the two Taiwanese wrote an LVS software package for it. SEL's computers lacked many resources like virtual memory, which forced the two to make their LVS package very efficient and fast. And since LVS is only just part of a larger design rule checking suite, they had to write those bits too. They named this software suite Dracula. Design Rule Checker, DRC, Dracula, get it? SEL later shut down their chipset design team. Knowing that they were going to lose their jobs, Antel, Huang, and Chow decided to do a startup. They bought the rights for Dracula from their former employer and started ECAD in 1983. Dracula quickly distinguished itself from the rest of the field. It ran on many different types of hardware, including Unix workstations. Customers loved this because it let them cheaply and rapidly upgrade their rigs. And thanks to Huang and Chow, Dracula was also fast and efficient. Verification has, is, and always will be a major challenge for chip designers. The more circuits on the design, the more challenging it is to verify. Fast, efficient DRC software that can be ported over to better hardware had the edge in the market, and that is what Dracula was. The same year that Dracula emerged from its coffin to attack the industry, a former National Semiconductor engineer named Jim Solomon founded Solomon Design Automation, or SDA. Solomon was a respected analog chip designer there, but was then getting really into coding, writing computer models to test his analog circuit designs. After talking with various Berkeley professors, he starts pushing National Semiconductor to get into heavy-duty design automation. Charlie Spork, National Semiconductor's legendary CEO, doesn't want to do that, but encourages Solomon to start his own company, even providing seed money. Various other customers like GE, Harris, and Ericsson join in too. And thus we have SDA, a placeholder name after the original name, ISIS, was taken. SDA struggled for several years to ship a product, but people stuck with them thanks to the persistent effort and two other things. First, they too were software only. This was a decision influenced by immersion in the Berkeley software community with the rise of Unix and its new programming language, C. This portability differentiated them from all the other CAD vendors selling hardware-accelerated solutions. Second, SDA's product was pretty fantastic. The concept had a design quote-unquote framework architecture that let chip designers link software tools from other vendors inside a common, user-friendly interface and database. You can then use SDA software to lay out the circuits and route the wires. Meanwhile, the marriage between Calma and GE is not going well. Japanese semiconductor competition and the aforementioned rise of cheap workstations from the likes of Sun began battering the company's fortunes. 1985 was one of the worst years in semiconductor industry history. After a few years of losses, GE and its now overrated CEO Jack Welch realized they couldn't earnings manipulate their way around in this business and decided to get out, which meant imminent layoffs. Enter one GE employee, a Dutchman named Art De Geus. Inside the company, De Geus and his cohorts had developed an automation tool called Socrates. It did synthesis for a specific type of circuit. You give it a high-level logical function, and 20 minutes later, it gives you a netlist. It was good technology. Realizing this and that he was probably about to lose his job, DeGeus went to his managers at GE and asked to spin off as a startup. GE agrees and even throws in some seed money. DeGeus raises the rest of their $4.7 million or so of initial funding from other industry players and venture capital. The company first started in North Carolina as Optimal Solutions in 1986. A year later, they moved to Mountain View, California and changed their name to Synopsys, an abbreviation of the terms Synthesis and Optimization Systems. As I mentioned earlier, Synopsys' killer app was logic synthesis. This means allowing designers to design circuits just by writing out a high-level abstraction of what those circuits are supposed to do, almost like a compiler but for silicon hardware. Logic synthesis had long been pursued by the industry, but Synopsys was the first to commercialize it in 1987 with Socrates. It not only worked, but also worked far faster and more efficiently than a human could. Famously, DeGeus visited Sun Microsystems and its co-founder, Andy Bechtolsheim, and they happened to be in the same office complex. Sun ran a demo where they compared the software circuit design to a human one. They found that the software could make a design 30% smaller and 30% faster and do it in just minutes. Sun became one of Synopsys' critical early clients and helped drive their technology progress. Synthesis unlocked a great deal of designer productivity. DeGeus has said before that Synthesis helped turn what was before computer-aided design, or CAD, to electronic design automation, or EDA. ECAD and SDA's founders and top managers had known each other for a long time, having all worked at National Semiconductor. Their products complemented each other quite well, and in fact, they could have started off as one company. But Paul Huang had already finished Dracula and wanted to go to market with it. SDA's products at the time, unfortunately, were not yet done. Fast forward a few years to 1987. SDA finally got their stuff out and both companies are doing well. It is time for them to go public in an IPO and cash out their investors. Through much of that year, the stock market was hot. ECAD, with sales of $23 million and profits of $3.2 million, filed to go public in June 1987. It goes through and ECAD raises $11 million. This was good, so SDA, then making $18 million of sales, filed to go public too. But the day of their IPO was Monday, October 19th, 1987, or Black Monday, one of the worst stock crashes in history. Obviously, you have to cancel the IPO. What now? Later, ECAD's bankers reached out to SDA and suggested a merger. In the wake of the crash, their stock, which IPO'd at $10 to $12, had fallen to just $3. A merger made much sense. It would be a way for SDA to go public and for ECAD to bulk up in order to compete in a challenging market. The two companies were also increasingly encroaching on each other's turf, particularly in physical verification. Talks began in December, announced in February 1988, and finalized in May 1988. Paul Antal, one of ECAD's co-founders, was made CEO of the combined company, named Cadence Design, in part because of his age and experience. But that did not last very long. Antal was kicked upstairs to the chairmanship, and SDA COO and president Joe Costello became CEO. Young, charismatic, and very importantly to me, 6'6" tall, Costello would lead Cadence to $1 billion of annual revenues over the next 9 years. TSMC's founding in 1987 and subsequent rise expanded the market for EDA software. Now, fabless companies can make a chip without paying millions of dollars to build a fab. For those companies, EDA tools were essential for getting those chips to market as fast as possible without expensive respins or redos. A team of three can produce a fully custom VLSI chip, meaning tens or hundreds of thousands of transistors, in just months, a quarter of the time it would have otherwise taken. In the early years, Synopsys and Cadence were sort of complements. Designers can use Synopsys' logic synthesis tools to produce a netlist for their chip, and then they fed that netlist into Cadence's layout and physical verification tools. So you can see it as Synopsys being stronger on the quote-unquote front end of chip design, turning RTL language into netlists. They had virtually no competition in this space until 1990, and early on focused heavily on that space. Meanwhile, Cadence dominated the quote-unquote back end, of semiconductor design, layout, verification, and simulation. This dynamic started to change in 1989 as Cadence embarked on an aggressive acquisition spree. From 1989 to 1994, they bought 5 companies, looking to add complementary products for their portfolio. They were also interested in buying system-level tools to help designers make circuit boards or even entire electronics products. For instance, their first acquisition in 1989, Tangent Systems, added an advanced place and route product to their existing layout software. That same year, 1989, Cadence tried to acquire Synopsys, along with another EDA company called Gateway Design Automation. Gateway had created the Verilog hardware description language, as well as a fast simulator for it. Synopsys licensed Verilog for their own product, so the two were very close. Costello approaches the CEOs of both companies, Dr. Prabhu Goel of Gateway and Harvey Jones of Synopsys, at a Las Vegas craps table and proposes a 3-way merger. Gateway eventually accepts, while Synopsys did not. Synopsys CEO Harvey Jones said that they had, quote, a different worldview on where they were going. That meant staying independent. Cadence CEO Costello later said with a laugh in an oral history, "We got one of the two. Had we gotten the other one, the end of the game would have happened right then in all of design automation for all of history." In addition to acquisitions, Cadence had another major growth driver, international. They were very aggressive in selling into the Japan market, a trend dating back to their days as SDA. In 1989, they served 9 of the top 10 Japanese semiconductor companies. As we moved into the 1990s, customer needs began to change. Moore's Law started to really accelerate. Transistor counts began to explode, and that changed the purpose of EDA software from simply raising designer productivity to helping designers manage new complexity. The way to manage that complexity was to introduce more abstraction. In the beginning, designers drew and placed individual gates. Now they only needed to describe how circuits should behave by writing high-level hardware description language like Verilog, now a public standard, and let the code do the rest. This greater abstraction implies a need to more tightly integrate the semiconductor design process. I know I had separated them earlier as discrete steps, but Moore's Law has pushed that all together, and that in turn has pushed the industry towards consolidation. Synopsys went public in 1992. Though they still had a dominant position in synthesis software, by the mid-1990s, that market had matured and various competitors had started to make headways into that business. Synopsys realized that the best defense was a good offense, so they too began acquiring startups to expand their product offering and take advantage of new product trends like system on chips. They made 5 acquisitions between 1994 and 1995. Since then, they've been as aggressive as Cadence has been. Between 1989 and 2006, the two companies would each make over $3 billion in acquisitions. By the end of this era, the whole industry had consolidated around our new big 3, Cadence, Synopsys, and Mentor Graphics. Mentor being the sole survivor of the old second-generation companies. Mentor was later acquired by Siemens in 2017 and was renamed to Siemens EDA. There are still EDA startups founded each year, armed with a smart team, a nifty idea, and a passion to take down the giants. But unlike with the first and second generation of EDA startups, these startups have yet to displace the incumbents even 2 decades later. And that is probably why the space struggles to raise funding today. In the mid-2000s, EDA industry observers like Joe Costello started complaining about stagnancy in the industry. Cadence and Synopsys clearly won the market, but that market has stopped growing. Young talent started chasing the hot new thing. For instance, Jerry Yang and Dave Filo studied EDA before leaving to found Yahoo. The stock market seems to have agreed at the time. The duopoly stock prices languished for over a decade. At one point, they were barely worth what they paid for their acquisitions. That only changed sometime in late 2016 or early 2017. I wonder what changed since then. Perhaps the introduction of advanced packaging or the revitalization of shrinkage with EUV, geopolitics. What do you guys think? All right, everyone, that's it for tonight. Thanks for watching. Subscribe to the channel, sign up for the Patreon, and I'll see you guys next time.